Welcome to episode 128 of The Brainy Business, Understanding the Psychology of Why People Buy. In today's episode, I'm excited to introduce you to Matt Wallert, author of Start at the End, How to Build Products That Create Change. Ready? Let's get started.
You are listening to The Brainy Business Podcast, where we dig into the psychology of why people buy and help you incorporate behavioral economics into your business, making it more brain friendly. Now here's your host, Melina Palmer.
Hello, hello everyone. My name is Melina Palmer and I want to welcome you to the Brainy Business Podcast. Today, I'm so excited to introduce you to Matt Wallert, author of Start at the End, How to Build Products That Create Change. One of my favorite quotes from Matt is one that shows how we're kindred spirits. He says, "If behavior is your outcome and science is your process, you're a behavioral scientist. No PhD required." Matt was one of the first behavioral scientists to leave academia and work in industry, which he's done for over 15 years now. He was the head of behavioral science at Microsoft, the first chief behavioral officer in the healthcare industry while at Clover Health, and does tons of awesome projects along the way, some of which you'll learn about in today's episode. During our conversation, we'll talk about lots of concepts that have past episodes on the show, including those on anchoring, relativity, changing behavior for good, how to experiment, and many more. There are links to all those past episodes and, of course, links to connect with Matt and get your own copy of Start at the End within the show notes, which can be found within the app you're listening to or at thebrainybusiness.com/128. Those already on the Brainy Business list got a direct link from me in the email you receive every Friday. Not on the list yet? Simply sign up for any freebie at thebrainybusiness.com and you'll be automatically added. And for those of you in the States, you can sign up easily by texting the word brainy, B-R-A-I-N-Y, to 33777. You'll be added to the list and get access to a super secret subscribers page with more than 50 freebies as a thank you. I had so much fun talking to Matt. You're going to love this banter, I'm sure. So let's just jump right in. Matt Wallert, welcome to the Brainy Business Podcast.
Melina, thanks so much for having me.
Yes, I'm very excited to have you here with me today. As we said, as we were getting ready, I've already informed you you're my new best friend and you don't have a choice in that. It's happening.
And yet you won't let me curse on your podcast.
I know. I promise. It's behind the scenes stuff. It's not me.
Listeners, this is what you're getting. You're getting edited, censored behavioral science.
I'm sorry. I have to censor myself too, I promise. So we get to blame, I don't know, Apple or something, somebody that does the podcast stuff. So excited to have you here with us. You've done so many amazing things across your life and career, and would love to hear just your story of how you got into behavioral science and what you love about it.
So I took the world's worst intro psych class in college with a professor who's a brilliant researcher, but not a good teacher. At all. He like read from his notes and you couldn't ask questions or go to the bathroom or move because it would throw him off. And then he would just start over at the beginning of the notes.
Yikes.
And so it was, you know, he just read off a script. It was not good. And so despite my horrible intro psych experience, I did take a second psych class with a guy who is a phenomenal teacher, Andrew Ward at Swarthmore. And I had this really formative experience. And I've told this story many times and I, to this day, it still remains a huge part of my life. So Andrew taught the psychology of self-control. And we were reading about the IAT, and I said, okay, I don't disagree with the data, but I feel like they've overreached on their conclusion. And Andrew said the most magical thing I think a teacher can ever say to somebody, which is, well, the field agrees, right? The field agrees with this interpretation of data, but this is science. And there is an orderly way to respond. And it doesn't have to do with how eloquent you are or how powerful you are. You can respond through an experiment. So if you want to come to my lab and run an experiment, like that's how you would prove that they were overreaching. Which I later did. It was not the first, it was the first study I ever did, although not the first paper that ever came out because of the way academia works, but I did eventually publish that I was right and they were wrong. So, haha. And so, you know, being right will instantly addict you to any field, right? That feeling of validation. And, you know, Andrew wasn't perfectly right. We all know that at this point, gender and ethnicity and all sorts of other things do in fact come into play in the scientific dialogue. But science in its pure form, right, isn't that. We corrupted that. And so I got really addicted to this beautiful level playing field that was science, and then started doing a lot of applied work, right? Had done a bunch of research. You know, it was interesting, actually. I got into a bunch of PhD programs, and Tom Gilovich from Cornell called me. He's like, hey, we really want to get you. I know you're worried about money. We have this great scholarship for you, like, you know, fellowship, whatever. We will help you do it. But I just want to make sure you keep talking about application, and I want to make sure you know, like, we're a research institution. And, you know, I think he was onto something that I wasn't ready to say for myself yet, which was, you know, that I needed to leave academia and then I needed to go out and do an applied work. And so, you know, two really pivotal career shifts, right? One where I got into science as sort of this interesting way of talking about the truth and talking to each other about the truth. And then this interesting inflection moment of like, oh no, it really is applied truth, not sort of functional truth, not objective truth. And so then, you know, went out into industry, did a year of PhD and went, nope, wrong. Never mind. And went out into the industry and started doing applied psych and have spent the last 15-ish years doing that and love it. I mean, I really, really love what I do. And I love that I get to participate in sort of a magical time when like behavioral science has been on the ascendancy and it's still in its infancy. I think it's still early, but I think about, I do feel really lucky for the timing piece of it. You know, I talk to tons and tons and tons of young people and other people who are newly discovering the field, right? As a very visible behavioral scientist, lots of people reach out to me. And I'm very conscious of the fact that I just got to be there when it was easy to be an applied behavioral scientist because there were so few barriers and no one else was doing it. And so, you know, you could sort of make up the rules as you went along. And it's been also been fun. I mean, it's been fun in my career to get to change what I was doing in the sense that like when I first started, I had to spend an hour in every meeting explaining what the heck behavioral science actually was, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas now people are sort of familiar and they kind of know, you know, they've like read Thinking Fast and Slow or something or The Undoing Project or something. They're sort of like, okay, we get it. You know, I still have to do a fair bit of explanation of the process, but at least I don't have to try and explain the outcome anymore. And that I think has been sort of magical. So I feel really lucky. I enjoy the career. I keep doing it.
Yeah, right. And so you have been at Microsoft and led the behavioral science initiatives there, done some work with GetRaised.com, with Clover Health. Where are you these days?
San Diego. No, I had an interesting, so, you know, Clover and I sort of came to Clover at the beginning of the year and said, hey, I think I've accomplished what I want to accomplish here. I'm ready to be on my way out. Took a couple of months to get that accomplished. And so left Clover in mid-March, early March. And
perfect timing.
It actually was perfect timing. So my co-parent and I always meet in Palm Springs for vacation with our son. And so I met them out there and that was like March 14th or whatever, when New York City is just on fire, right? And actually, we should stop using on fire because California, where I am now, is literally on
literally.
Fire. a death trap. New York was a death trap. How about that?
Fair enough.
And so we just couldn't go back, right? We were planning to spend a week. And so we just stayed in Palm Springs, eventually moved over to San Diego, stayed in San Diego, And at some point, we just looked at each other and were like, we need to make a long-term plan. And so said, all right. And Steph said it well. She said, look, this is going to be a really bleeped up year, no matter where you are. And so we might as well have an adventure, right? If we're going to have a bleep up year, it would be in New York and have a bleep up year. So you might as well have it somewhere different. And so we just agreed to take San Diego for a year. But what the reason that transitioning out actually helped was we didn't have any childcare, right? So I had this 4-year-old that's like running around going nuts and no childcare. And Steph, my co-parent, is a fantastic clinical psychologist. And so she has this patient load that like, despite COVID, you know, you can't, like you're supporting these people who need help. And so she could continue to work full time while I sort of got to take care of Bear, which was awesome. And, you know, finally, when we decided to settle here, got some childcare. And so now for the last month or so, I've been starting to talk to companies about new roles. There's a lot out there, a lot going on in the industry right now at big companies and small. I do think I have been on a little bit of a vision quest as I thought about the next role, and you know, have pretty much decided that I want to spend most of my time sort of pivoting an organization to behavioral science as opposed to being a centralized behavioral science team that ships products, right? Mm-hmm. I'm happy to say products as examples, but I don't think that the dominant course of my work will be as the head of product in the next role, although it's possible. I've had a lot of really fun time. I've been working with MasterCard and a bunch of other folks who, T-Mobile, a bunch of people who read the book and then were like, okay, this is the way we want to reorient our product organizations. And then going through that, it's really interesting products of how do you get, you know, 500 people to sort of go from one way of building things to another way of building things, which is its own kind of behavioral science challenge.
Right.
And so that's where really where I'm having the most fun these days is in the sort of like, how do you take these people who have all of the skills of building things, but are still fundamentally building things that are not from a behavioral science perspective, you know, that are not user appropriate, that aren't based on sort of like outcome behaviors, and really get them into this new place. And it's been interesting, right? In many ways, I think younger people actually have an easier time with it. Like the younger product managers, it is more concordant with, I think, how young people are used to thinking about product, which I think is good, right? The fact that like product has started kind of co-evolving with behavioral science is really a strong promise, right? Advances in data science, advances in user research, right? Qualitative research, quantitative research, essentially, have, I think, prepared younger PMs to more fully sort of embrace a like, you know, sort of behavioral centric version of this. You know, the people who it's really a struggle for, you know, if you're a 45-year-old director of product management in some big company, it's a big mind shift to start going from sort of like some giant waterfall diagram or like the business wants us to build this and therefore we shall build it, as opposed to like the business wants this as an outcome and here are the things we need to build to accomplish that outcome. That's a big shift.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I think age plays a factor. Lots of things are kind of in there.
Right. Well, and just, you know, general tenure, I think, is part of it too, right? As you've been, regardless of age, if you've been there for a long time and a company's been doing something the same way for a long time, it, you know, in industry or company type probably plays a lot into that as well.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, part of it is the more heavily regulated the industry, right? Then it gives people, you know, license to sort of say, well, we just don't do that here, right? There are also industries, you know, having done medical and finance and all sorts of other things, you know, I've taken the same skill set and applied it across a bunch of industries over my career. You know, it's interesting what behaviors an industry says are immutable. So every behavior seems to have some mental model of like, these things are immutable. So a good example is like in medicine, most insurance companies and other people will tell you, you can't change what doctors people pick. People have strong individual preferences. They have relationships and connections. Like you can't change those PCP relationships.
And you say, watch me.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But I was like, all right, well, game on, y'all. Bleepers, let's go. I'm just self-bleeping now.
I appreciate it.
It's on. And I think, you know, finance, same thing. I got in a really, really big argument, like screaming match argument with like the head of risk at American Express once, where what it really came down to is she was basically saying people come out of the womb with their credit score tattooed on their butt, that people's finance behaviors were essentially immutable, right? And I think people often don't think of the implications of the things that they say, right? You know, one of my favorite examples of this is when people are like, well, we hire the best candidates and you magically hire all white men. Are you saying you think white men are better than everyone else? Like, because that's the natural conclusion of the thing you just said. And it's interesting to me. So every industry has its own sort of beliefs about like what can't be changed. And I do take to your point earlier, I take a particular kind of relish in being like, oh yeah, bring it on. Yeah. I'll raise people's credit scores 50 points in 6 months. Like, let's go.
Like, we can do this. Don't you worry.
That's right. Have fun.
Yeah. At least you're getting challenged for to save the world, I guess, instead of be a supervillain.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I think I always think of behavioral science. I'm very candid about this in talks, right? It can be applied for ill and has been applied for ill and across a variety of domains, right? You know, there was a great New York Times story about the Uber team, which I think did do some things that were not ethically sound, that were worrisome. I have a whole chapter on ethics in the book, right? Like, I think ethics are very important. And I think it is hard. I mean, once you're in a context, it's very, very, very hard to see the water. And so I think you need external checks to help you step away from that. The thing I always tell audiences, I said I've made this pivot more towards helping people be behavioral scientists and think of themselves as behavioral scientists as opposed to like shipping a bunch of behavioral products, although I shipped a product yesterday, so I guess maybe that's a lie, but maybe I don't know what I'm talking about, but that's not...
You're full of it. You're a liar.
Well, I'm a white man. This is what I do. But what I always sort of tell people is like, look, you can use this in good ways and bad ways, but you should know that if you use this in a bad way, like, I'm a lot better at it than you are. I have a lot more experience and I will fight you. And so, right, like I do think there is a little bit of, and maybe it's just the sort of masculinity aspect of me, but like there is a little bit of like girding up every day to go fight what I think is a very real fight for the behavior of humans, right? Mm-hmm. If what the soul is our expressed behavior, we are fighting for souls, right? And there are people fighting on one side and I'm fighting on the other side and we're going to see who wins. You know, I'm optimistic about the state of applied science and the goodness of applied science. You know, if you zoom out from human behavior, it almost always has gone up and to the right. It's easy to see the localized downs, right? But, it's a little like the stock market. You have to step farther back. But, man, those localized downs will really get you down sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Well, let's talk a little bit about some of the projects that you've worked on. And I know we've talked about the Bing translator before. And I know that you've done so many amazing projects. And I really love the thought process that you go through when, you know, the problem is presented. You and others in applied behavioral science, there's so just that discovering what the real question and problem is where I find that most people that aren't trained in that applied behavioral science, that's where the real misstep is, right? It's the first piece and you're finding the, you know, the right answer to the wrong question. And so it's just not going to work. Whereas if you really sit down with the problem and see what's really going on, you can get these amazing outcomes like you have had across your career. So do you have maybe some favorite examples and projects that...
I mean, I think even behavioral scientists like have this problem. It's very hard to write a complete behavioral statement from the beginning, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, I've had this 15-year love affair with building inclusion side projects. You mentioned Get Raised, right? But like through the thing I launched yesterday, I think someone was asking me to count the other day. I think I had 8 or 10 of these side projects. You know, I released them at a pretty good clip over the last 5 or 6 years. And in many ways, the reason I keep releasing things in this vein are because I keep getting it wrong. Right. So like Get Raised is a great example, right? $3 point something billion, $3.3, I think we're at $1 billion in raises, like huge amount of money, you know, helping women ask for and get raises more successfully. And yet it's a busted product in the sense that what it does is get women to present things in a way that is different than what they've been socialized to present them as, right? And ideally, like in an ideal world, women shouldn't have to ask for raises, right? Like that, like they should be paid fairly from the beginning. And so there shouldn't need to be this correcting factor. And so you can release something, but then that creates exactly the behavior you want, which is asking for a raise, creates $3.3 billion in raises, like it is a good thing. Like I'm not saying Get Raised is bad, but it is certainly incomplete, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't solve the problem that, I mean, you're just going to dust your hands and walk away, right? There's a next thing and a next thing and a next thing and a next thing, right? All the way. And so I fully expect that I'll keep releasing things in this vein because every time you change a behavior, you learn something about the next behavior you need to change, right? That's why many of my products, you know, there's a shift 3 or 4 years ago, where, you know, I go from building mostly products that target women to mostly products that target men, getting closer and closer to sort of the root behaviors, right? So, you know, a thing that came out yesterday, Work With Me Again, which is a feedback gathering tool, tries to help anybody, but, you know, it's not so secretly targeted at men, recognize that they might have a problem. Right. And so, you know, do this sort of, it does a bunch of statistics. It's a very simple product, right? It's a Google hack, Google Sheets plus Google Forms, right? So Google Form asks people that you previously worked with from 1, actively avoid working with me to 5, actively seek out working with me again. Concrete behavioral measure. Like we know bias creeps in when we start doing all of these like sort of subjective, you know, ratings of performance. That's a very clear behavior, right? Melina and I worked together before. Would we work together? You know, would Melina be like, not in 1,000 years? Or like, yeah, well, maybe there's something going on here, right? Like that's, I think, a really key and important thing. And then it asks some demographic questions, right? You know, so that we can start to do, and then we do statistics, right? Do whites versus non-whites feel differently about working with you again? Do women and non-binary versus men feel differently about working with you again, et cetera? Are you doing better now than you used to, right? So we can look at recency effects. Like, was it better a long time ago or was it better now? And so I think that there's this sort of interesting, you know, moment where we get men to recognize, oh yeah, I have a problem. And that's a behavior. Being willing to vocalize that you have a problem is a behavior, and a behavior we can go create. So yeah, I think there is this like long-term fascination as I go deeper and deeper in products. And it's interesting to me in a way that like, and maybe someday I should just sit down and do this, but all of the products have been interconnected for me, even in wildly different industries. Like getting people to choose different PCPs that are going to be good for them is absolutely in every way connected to, you know, work I did on budgeting 10 years ago.
Right.
Those lines are invisible when you look at them. But like, if you sit down and really track it, there is something going on there where, and that, what's interesting to me, like the difference between junior behavioral scientists and more senior behavioral scientists is just experience, right? It's not for anybody who can learn the framework, right? Like I argue people do behavioral science all the time. It is about having done it enough that you can sort of get to understand how things are connected in ways that you might not have previously understood, right? Mm-hmm. It's not understanding that you need to change behavior. It's understanding that these are likely levers for behavior change. There's a great scene actually in Hustlers with J-Lo, where she's like, as the older stripper trying to explain stripping to a younger stripper. It is a great scene actually about experience, right? It's a great scene about sort of like, there's nothing actually different. Like on the surface, they're both dancing. They're both like doing the same things. But the orientation that J-Lo has in that moment, the explanation that she has for why she does what she does and how she does it, I think is a great encapsulation of experience.
Interesting. I have seen that movie, but it's been a while, so I'll have to...
Well, probably you didn't also watch it with being like, this is an interesting encapsulation of, this is what happened, this is why I can't watch movies, because I'm like, I could use this clip in a talk.
Come on, man. You know that we are very cut from the same cloth. Like I've talked about on the show before, we're from traveling all the time and whatever. It's like my husband's the most patient person in the world, to where we'd be walking through an airport or we're on vacation somewhere. I'm like, hey, wait, stop just a second. I need to take a picture of this advertisement because...
This is a really good example of the thing.
Like, oh, look at the thing. They're totally misusing relativity right there. I can see it. I'm going to fix it.
It's interesting. It is interesting to me how much of communication is just quick analogy making, right? The ability to say, Melina, what are you interested in? And then find a way to relate that to the thing that I'm trying to teach you. I was boxing with somebody the other day and trying to teach them how to box. And she was a volleyball player. And she has this tendency in boxing to sort of over-rotate and like kind of wind up. And I'm like, you know, that's fine, right? I get why you're doing that, but it's like volleyball, right? You need to have the tap, right? You need to be able to just tap it over the thing as much as you need to be able to spike it. And even if you spike 99% of the time, the other person has to know that you could tap it, right? They have to have that fear that you could tap it.
Right.
Otherwise, they'll just play far back. And that clicked for her. And it is that live analogy making that I think so often makes behavioral science work. It's that ability to sort of help people understand how behaviors are similar across domains.
Yeah, absolutely. So in my corporate life, which, you know, I was in what became a $500 million financial institution, a credit union. So, you know, that's like corporate light, I guess.
I love credit unions. I love credit unions. I love the credit unions. I love letter to credit unions.
But when I was working there and I was, you know, running the marketing department, and I started doing freelance work on the side, which was like, I'm doing like heavy strategic type stuff in my job. And so, you know, I'm going to be reading and doing all these things anyway. And I'm just grammatically correct it. My brain's doing this anyway as I'm reading, so I might as well just start doing editing type projects. And I somehow ended up being a book editor for just all sorts of books, where I had a friend who helped people get their books written. And I was editing like a book from a Myers-Briggs personality expert, from someone who, it was this like dress for success type book of different personal stylists giving their tips. I did one on the how to create the dressing room experience and how that can change stuff. Just all sorts of very different books, but to what you're saying, the behavior is the same. And that's like when I talk with potential clients and they say, well, have you worked with X? Like, have you worked with someone like me? And where for me, it's the, if I haven't, you know, say, you know, no, but like the lever, the behavior is the same. Our brain is doing the same thing, whether I'm deciding if I'm going to litter while I'm driving down the street or what brand of toothpaste I want to buy, right? The brain is doing all the same stuff. And so knowing what it does and what it's likely to do, like you said, just gives the things that we can be testing, asking the right questions. The application itself is secondary, tertiary, whatever it is, kind of down the way. But understanding those brain pieces is more important.
Yeah, it's interesting, right? Like this is where the sort of lab versus field or even sort of multicultural or, you know, sort of ethnically sensitive sort of behavioral science comes in, right? Because there is this tendency in behavioral science to be like, ah, yes, there are these immutable rules that everybody in every circumstance applies. And you're like, no, it's just, you know, circumstances are sophisticated. You know, Dan Egan keeps like a record of everything that he tries at Betterment. And he's like, look, you know, lab studies are not, you know, if you try and replicate a lab study in real life, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, right? The key is that you tried it small and tried to replicate it before you just blew it out to everybody. The number of companies who seem to just be like, hey, I read Thinking Fast and Slow and I'm going to take 10 heuristics and dump them into everything that I do. I'm like, that's not how it works, man. Science is required. There is a process of like testing that, you know, these things.
I feel like we need the versus the adulting, right? It's like, I'm sciencing. Yay.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like, it's amazing. And this, you know, I think, this is where I think diversity of teams really helps us, right? Because there are so many things where people are like just blindly applying lab studies where I think a halfway halfway competent person from another culture would be like, well, that's not how that works for me, right? In this, like in my cultural context. And so one of the reasons diversity ends up being so interesting and important, in particularly in behavioral science and when you're trying to do, you know, behavior change in a room is just saying like, nope, like that assumption is not it. Like we have to test that assumption, right? If science is the testing of all assumptions, right? Assume nothing, test everything. Then one of the most valuable things that diversity can bring us is the ability to say, you're making an assumption, to recognize these. Like if science says test all assumptions, what diversity can do is say, that is an assumption. Right? It can call out the places that are assumptions that we don't even, you know, when you're immersed in a cultural context, it's very hard to see that something is an assumption, right? So that's why I think diversity and science go well together, is because science tests the assumption, diversity calls out the assumption. And then, you know, you just sort of repeat that process over and over and over, and that's how you build good things. And so I think it is an interesting sort of problem of like, how do you get people to really anchor on the, I talk about this when I talk about behavioral science, because I don't think people grok what I mean when I say behavioral science, right? I mean it literally as two distinct and separate words, right? And it is a verb essentially, right? It is something you do, not like a field of study in the way that people, like it's not a set of lab studies. Like they're not like, here's the pile of behavioral science research. Behavior is an outcome, science is a process. It is an action, not a noun, right? And I think that people often don't clearly understand that behavioral science isn't just a book I read.
Right. Yeah. You definitely, it's a lifestyle. You are an inquisitive, curious person that's when you see something out in the world or someone says, this is the way it is, you go, but why? You know, does it have to be that way? I bet we could find a way that would be untrue. You know, that I bet I can figure out the way to change whatever that preconceived notion is, I guess, that like challenging of that status quo, but understanding why status quo bias is even a thing and how it works and what is at the root of it allows you to understand the way you could differently frame what's going out and, you know, all of those different things that you can be testing to make a new normal.
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting maybe encapsulation of the difference between sort of academic behavioral science and applied behavioral science, right? Like academic behavioral science is about the why of the way things are.
Right.
And applied behavioral science is the, yeah, but I can change that. Right? Like it's the changing of the way things are, right? It isn't, I am no longer all that interested in why things are the way they are. or rather, I'm only interested in why things are the way they are to the extent that it allows me to change them. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care about why people voted for Trump in isolation. I care about why people voted for Trump so that I can get them to not vote for things that are oppressing, like that are bad for them, right? Like harmful to themselves. And so I think that there's a tendency for academic researchers to be able to distance themselves from something in a way that, I mean, maybe that's ultimately my downfall as an academic researcher. And the reason I end up in applied is I just can't create, it isn't possible for me to create that distance. It's interesting. I gave a TED talk, which I don't think is posted yet, but on the TED channel, but was posted live a couple months ago, in which I talk about sort of compassionate scientific activism, but that I would be unsatisfied with any of them in isolation. So I use this metaphor of walking into a spider web, right? And so compassion says, because if you see someone walking into a spider web from far away, they look nuts. But as soon as you understand that there is a spider web, you're like, oh, I get it. You are acting in a totally rational way. I just didn't understand the things that were shaping your behavior, which I think is the underlying, almost all misunderstandings across cultural and other kinds of borders are due to a misunderstanding of the pressures that affect that other person's life, right? They are reacting in a totally rational, logical, like, this is why I don't like the like predictably irrational version of this, is like, they're not irrational. They're totally rational in the world in which they live.
Right. Their context makes it so that this does actually make sense.
Yeah. Like it almost always makes sense in context if you understand context, right? And so compassion, so if we take the notion of spider web, so compassion says, I can't see it, but I know a spider web exists, right? I understand how you are acting is rational to you. I'm not saying I approve of it, right? I'm not saying like that's a good way to act. I'm not blessing it, but I'm validating it. It is a reasonable, like it's reasonable by the mere fact that you are doing it. It is valid because you are feeling it or doing it. So compassionate, scientific, right? Like, okay, there is a spider web. I'm going to go find it, right? Science says I'm going to go find it. It's not just saying it exists. It's saying I'm going to go find it. But that's not enough for me. For me, let's not make it a judgment. I am unsatisfied with merely describing the spider web. There's this scene in As Good As It Gets where I can't even remember the exact quote, so I'll just make it up. But like, by the end of the movie, Jack Nicholson and Greg Kinnear are like friends, and Jack Nicholson's in a panic about how he is losing the love of Helen Hunt. And Greg Kinnear's trying to give him advice. And Jack Nicholson says, I'm drowning here and you're describing the waves, right? Which is a little bit what science sometimes feels like to me, right? Mm-hmm. Like people are at serious harm in the world and you're sitting here describing how they're at harm. And you're like, what? Like, what are you doing?
That's I recently had Steve Wendell on the show.
Oh, yeah. I love Steve.
Oh, he's so awesome. I know he's my other new best friend. In case you don't know Steve, that's a thing now. But he has this great example of if you're walking down the beach and you see a fish in the sand, what is it that you're going to do? Are you going to yell at the fish and say, what are you doing? You need to be in the water. Don't you know you're going to die if you're out here? Do you otherwise explain like, well, let me tell you how your gills work and why you need to be in the water to be able to breathe? Like the fish doesn't need to know the mechanics of like what matters, but it sure as bleep knows it needs to be in the water, right?
Like I'm drowning here, man.
Yeah, I'm drowning in all this air. I don't know what to do. But when we think about when people have a problem and we're trying to help them to have a behavioral change of some kind, most of us resort to that yelling or educating. And that's where I had brought up the point. It's not even, a lot of people too would say like, fish, you dumb. Like, don't you know that you should be able to breathe air like me? Right? Which doesn't help either. But those are kind of what we go to instead of, digging the channel or picking up the fish to get it back into the water.
Pick up the fish, God. Do the thing. I don't understand. Yeah. Right? Compassionate scientific activism, right? Yeah. Like, I believe a spider web exists. I'm going to find the spider web and then I'm going to tear that thing down.
Yeah. I can teach you about the oxygen later, but you won't be able to know if I'm just like in my ivory sand tower over here.
Yeah. I mean, the number of academic debates about inclusion right now where I'm like, can we just do the work? Let's just do the work. How about we do the work right now? And maybe later we can have a whole lovely discussion about like whether or not like this version of inclusion was slightly better than that version of inclusion. Like feminism is notorious for this, right? Like, the number of times I've been in Twitter discussions where I like have to step back and be like, we're now arguing, we're like feminists arguing with feminists about how to do feminism, as opposed to like the 60% of men that don't think gender imbalance is a real thing. They're right. Just like, don't think that's real. like maybe we should be arguing with them instead. Like yeah. They seem like much more interesting people to argue with right now.
It's a bike shedding piece, right? I mean, you get a little bit of the nuance. It's easier to have this discussion with the people that we can relate on than it is to have the more difficult conversation and the bigger thing to tackle of actually, you know, fighting when you do get stuck in those little kind of nuance pieces.
Yeah. And it's not an exoneration. I've been as guilty of it as anybody. As I said, like I end up in the argument and then I'm like, wait a minute. This is, yeah.
Why are we doing
this? Why are we arguing about this? I don't want to argue about this with you. I want to argue about other stuff with him.
And I want you to help me argue with him. That's the, we're on the same side.
Let's just, I'll go all, like, I don't know. It's hard.
I love it. Well, I have so enjoyed our conversation. I think it's been a lot of fun to just get at the root of, you know, behavioral science, what it is. I know I have a quote of yours. You sort of touched on this, but because I was able to write it down, a thing that you said, then I can say it back to you. If behavior is your outcome and science is your process, you're a behavioral scientist, no PhD required. And so yep. Having that, I think, really encapsulates the mindset of the projects you can work on and the way that people can make change in their own life and in their organizations and, you know, just the way that you can think about the world can make a huge difference. If you're interested in applying it, you can do it.
Yeah. I often think about music, right? Once upon a time, there were really formal rules about music. Who could participate in music and how much education you had to have in music. And what an impoverished world we would live in if the only music that people were allowed to call music and distribute and make was like according to these rules, or you know, you had to be sort of like come out of wherever and done these things, you know, like behavioral science thrives when lots and lots and lots of people are doing it, right? Mm-hmm. And doing it a little better every day. And again, I'm not saying, I mean, there are people in the industry who get mad at me because they're like, but if, you know, if it's about everything, then it's about nothing. I'm not saying it's about everything. It has two distinctive characteristics. It must put behavior as an outcome. If it does not put behavior as an outcome, it is not behavioral science, right? And there are lots of people who call themselves behaviors. I kind of had an argument with a guy the other day where he was like, no, I'm just going to create this platform and people will do what they do on it. And I'm like, okay, but that's not behavioral science, man. That's fine. It's a fine thing for you to do. But behavioral science is about creating a specific outcome in advance, right? Knowing this, like it's like pre-registering a study, right? You have to be able to say, this is what I am trying to create. And then science is a process, right? So there are lots of things that create behavior, but don't use science as a process. That's fine. They're just not behavioral science. They're behavioral something else, right? They did other kinds of things. But, you know, if you didn't test and measure, that's not science. And that's okay. It's not a bad thing. It's just not behavioral science. So I'm not saying everything in the world is behavioral science. I'm just saying anyone that can do those two things, consciously articulate a behavior and then science their way towards it, is capable of being a behavioral scientist, capable of doing the thing. And we shouldn't set up, like, this is a little bit like a feminist arguing with feminist things. Like the number of times it's behavioral scientists arguing with other behavioral scientists about who can be a behavioral scientist, I'm like, I'm out, man. This is not the conversation I want to be having. Y'all are fine. Like, do your thing, but it ain't me.
Yeah, that's, I know right now there's the debate of the difference between behavioral science and behavioral economics and the definitions of it, which I too have sort of been like, well, I'm out.
I mean, that would be going on forever, right?
I know.
The economics ones, behavioral design, like who right. can be it, who cannot be it, what do you have to know, what do you have to not? It's hard. Right.
If we're doing good stuff, we're changing the world, you know, like, I don't know. I think it'll get defined eventually and be firm, and then we'll break those rules and it'll be something else. And it's all the circle of life, right?
Yeah, and I just hope I'm dead by then. Right. Like, I just hope it happens in an era that is not mine. And and you know, I hope the people around me are wise enough to call me out when I find myself getting into these discussions or having these debates or whatever. And you know, they're wise enough to remind me that I shouldn't be getting in this debate.
All right. Well, I feel like that is the perfect segue to say that you have now told everyone to follow Matt Wallert on Twitter, and you can call him out.
And call me out for things. Fantastic. Because I don't have enough trolls. Thanks.
Kindly and compassionately tell him he's in a spider web. Say, hey, man, there's a spider web here.
Spider web.
So if people do want to get in contact with you, for those who want to, which is everyone, for everyone who now wants to go get Start at the End, your book, and how to build products that create change, what's the best way to, there will be links in the show notes, but what's the best way to get in hold of you?
I mean, the book is available everywhere, Amazon, Barnes & Noble.
On the Zon?
On all the things. Is it all the things? I don't know. Buy a book. Watch a synopsis. Somebody put out a great video synopsis of it today. It was like 5 minutes long. And I was like, great, I love synopses. Dip your toe in, listen to this podcast, listen to other things before you actually spend $20 on a book. See if you really want to go deep. And then in terms of getting hold of me, right, you call that Twitter. So mattwallert.com.
Right.
Matt Wallert on Twitter.
So we've got at Matt Wallert. We've got mattwallert.com.
As discussed before the show, I am the only Matt Wallert. That's the benefit of having a weird last name. And so it's very easy to find me. I do have an open calendar block so that people can schedule time with me without an intro, without things, as a way to sort of, I do prioritize underrepresented minority folks, but you know, you can get time with me. So you can go find that link on LinkedIn or other places that you can get time. As I sort of said earlier, right? Like if you're moving in my direction, I'm happy to help you move in my direction. If you're trying to figure out how to use behavioral science to extort money from poor people, probably we're not going to get along real well.
Wow.
Just a theory. Just a guess. I don't know for sure, but just a guess.
I'm not 100% positive, but but pretty much.
strong bias. Strong theory.
Well, Matt, thank you so much for joining me on the show today. It has been a lot of fun chatting with you. I appreciate your self-censorship. thanks again. It's been great chatting.
Thanks for having me. It was super fun.
Thank you again to Matt Wallert for joining me on the show today. Don't you love all the cool stuff he's doing? And he's so much fun to talk to. We've only talked a few times so far, but I swear he keeps me laughing every time. Matt is so passionate about his work and helping to apply behavioral science. He's a wealth of knowledge and experience, and he loves talking through the concepts and problems, much like we talked about a couple weeks ago on the podcast about understanding the problem. I hope you've learned as much from him as I have, and look for him and one of his stories as a case study in my new book, which is coming out in May 2021. And because I know you want to learn more from Matt, get your own copy of his book, Start at the End, from the links in the show notes for this episode, which you can find at thebrainybusiness.com/128. You'll also find links to all those great past episodes so you can deepen your learning, including the ones on status quo bias, loss aversion, framing, bike shedding, the network effect, and more. And while you're on the Brainy Business website, don't forget to check out the year-end sale. There's a stellar deal and an awesome gift for everyone who books a strategy session or deep dive by the end of the year. You definitely don't want to miss out. I've made it easy with a link in the show notes, or you can go straight to the details about the sale at bit.ly/brainy2020. That's 2020. Thank you again to Matt Wallert, author of Start at the End, for joining me on the show today. It was wonderful to chat, laugh, and learn with you. Next week, on episode 129, we have another awesome episode full of behavioral economics of the Brainy Business. It's going to be a lot of fun. You won't want to miss it. Until then, thanks again for listening and learning with me. And remember to be thoughtful.
Thank you for listening to the Brainy Business Podcast. Molina offers virtual strategy sessions, workshops, and other services to help businesses be more brain friendly. For more free resources, visit thebrainybusiness.com.